St. Croix Rods, best rods on earth. Strike King, a legacy of domination for 50 years. Go Fish Ontario, it's catching. Welcome back to Extreme Angler. This week, I'm gonna answer a bunch of email questions I get on social media, Twitter, Facebook, you name it, about fishing rivers. Rivers and bass, it's phenomenal because you know why? Fish move all the time. Now, lakes, sometimes you pull a good fish off a specific spot, you gotta wait quite a while before another fish moves in. In a river, exact opposite. Half hour, 45 minutes to an hour, another fish moves in. It's like trout on a river and stuff. You pull one out from an undercut bank or a little hole, something like that. You go back 10 minutes later, there's another fish in there. They find the good stuff. So today, in a very popular river system here in southern Ontario, so I'm going to show you how I dissect it. But when I really want to get serious, pick up a small jig, like a little football jig like here by Strike King, put a little chunk on the back or a little baby rage craw, and go and dissect the good spots in a river the fish might hide behind, uses ambush spots. So sit back, relax, and hopefully the river is going to be good to me, so it can be good to you too. Let's go try. 6.5 feet of water. You know why I like fishing rivers? Because fish move. On lakes, you catch them off a dock or tree or stump or something like that, and you got to wait a while for fish to go back. A river, man, they're always moving around. Always. Current fluctuations back and forth, you know, just the way they are. And you pull a good fish off a decent spot, there's a good chance another one's gonna pull in. So I repeat, I go back to certain areas over and over again, you know, put waypoints, know where I am, and try to approach it from a different spot, sometimes use a different bait, and just go back to proven areas in a river, and usually they won't let you down. Okay, rod for the day, medium heavy, 7-1 St. Croix, like the Legend Extreme, Legend Tournament Bass, with a little 3/8 ounce, a football jig, the junior KVD chunk, 16 pound gamma fluorocarbon. I can feel those bites even on a cold front day lift up. You're gonna miss some, you're gonna catch some, but it gives me that little bit more advantage to feel those soft, subtle bites. 7 feet of water right here. I'm pitching up to about 3-4. Looking for little isolated stuff. Oh God, that's a big smallmouth. See what I mean? This dirty water. He was right behind it. Good one too. Oh God. Big smallmouth. They're taking their time in the morning, boy. They're taking their time. Look at that. He just barely touched the chunk sitting on that hook right there. Just barely touched it, nosed it. He wants that water temperature to come up just a bit. To go from kissing it to eating it. Wow. It's a big brownie. Pike bite. Is it Shark Week? You know what Shark Week is? I'll tell you what Shark Week is. It's something like Pike Week. Too much cover here not to have a big fish on it, unless he's on that other stump right there. My goodness, look at that. That's exactly what I'm talking about right there. Tree fell in the water, broke off. It's got branches. Branches come all the way down. Potentially fish just move in, sit around it. We just got to find the right one where fish is holding to it, and we'll feel that. Pow! Game on. Talk too soon, huh? There he is. How long it takes sometimes to get him inside that stuff? Look at this nasty stuff. He's not the biggest bass you've ever seen on Extreme Angler. Look at that hook penetration. But look where he was, man. The water's high, and he decided that I'm gonna sit right inside this junky stuff, and I'm not gonna bite it till you put the hook right on top of my head. But just a chunker, look how dark he is. He's got a nice position for a positional, you know, potential of a real big fish, but we're letting him go in the same spot right here where he came from. Ready, boy? Ready? And that's where he went. That's the kind of stuff sometimes you're fishing the river edges, points, trees, etc. You look over, you see this nasty stuff. If there's largemouth, that's where they're gonna be. Let's regroup, get back on the channel, see if we can get some smallmouth as well. So important to have a sonar when you fish in a river, because I'm looking for little contour edges in the weeds, you know, rock, doesn't matter what it is, where the fish potentially, where the current can come around, break, and make a little eddy or something where they hold to. It could be weeds, you know, pads, sticks, doesn't matter what it is, a big stump. So having the sonar, I can see the depth I'm in, 5 to 7 to 9 feet of water, and pitching up the high potential areas, but watching where I am all the time. Balance it, take your time. But having a sonar, whether it be a lake, river, reservoir, very important. That's what I talk about right there. That's what I meant right there. Look how fat he is too. Big, beautiful, small. You got it, good boy, huh? I'm good to you. Look how good these river fish fight. Ready? Oh yeah. Look at that, eh? That's what I mean right there, boy. Nice, big, fat river smallmouth. Look at him. Look where that jig is too. Look at that. Right where it should be. Sitting out off a tree and just, man, oh man, you're almost like swimming a jig. Thinking to yourself, is there a fish? There's a fish. Look how fat he is too. You know he's been eating. Tell you what, I'm gonna put a couple in the box just for some pictures and stuff. Keep the water running, keep them nice and fresh, keep going, and hopefully catch a few more. Let's put them in a box. That's a nice fish right there. Come here, you. Oh, look how dark that water is. Even the live well, you can tell. Look how dark it is. And look behind the boat. I'll show you right here, folks. Look at this. See what he was sitting on? This tree like this. So you can see the current, see how it's blowing down? It's going that way down. The fish will be sitting at the front of the tree. You know what I mean? He's looking at stuff coming at him. You can get him at the back too. But that fish, I threw up more in the front, threw it, swam it a bit, pulled him off the tree, lifted up, and he was already there. So spots like this, you can turn around, come back, but look right there. See that right there? I got another tree potentially to hit. So we'll keep going it, and hopefully the river is good to me. Be good to you too. Let's keep going. So you got any friends? Can see the bait moving. Oh, I missed one right there. See, look at that. What does that tell you? Right there, soft bite, man. Just holding it like this, or holding back here. Oh, wow. These are the best of both worlds. It's very frustrating, but just makes you a better angler, getting these fish to hook up. Wow, man. All of a sudden you feel a sensation and they've got it. Let me show you how I fish these trees and stuff. I just fished a tree up there, caught a good fish. Now I'm just drifting with the current and stuff. There's a really good birch tree that fell down. So I position myself so I don't drift on top of the tree. Make that first pitch in front where the current's going down. Because those fish, the current this way, they'll be facing that way. They won't be facing down river, they'll be facing up river. So I keep myself back, make those pitches out in front first. Then I'll work the outer edges, inner edges, just dissect the tree a bit, thinking where potentially that fish is sitting on the tree. And again, keep yourself back, constant. I'm making these pitches back and forth like this here in the high potential spots, letting it go down a bit and watching the line, sensitive rod. Anything happens, I'm setting hook. You know, I'll get hooked up a few times on the bottom of stuff, so what? This fish sometimes just come out of the tree, boom, grab it or the cover and go back in. So you see, I stayed back in the tree, make my pitches. You can fish much more efficiently than drifting on top of the stuff that you want to fish that's holding fish. And just down, bounce, lift, bounce, down, bounce. And then when I'm at the back of the tree, someone at the back where that slop and stuff is, who knows where they sit, like trout, all through an area like that. That's the way I do it. That's the way you could do it.
The Extreme Edge, presented by Strike King.
Hey folks, I'm Todd Faircloth here. And I want to talk to you a bait that I'm really, really excited about. It's the Strike King Rage Tail Structure Bug. It's got the same basic body design as our rodent does, but you can tell it's got appendages on the side here, and it's got them on the back here. And this bait is great for flipping wood, flipping docks, flipping grass. I've caught them pretty much doing anything. It's just a good all-around versatile bait. It's a good crawfish imitator. It's got good bulk to it, you know, but not too bulky. I normally Texas rig it just like this. I've got about a 3/8 ounce Strike King Tour Grade tungsten weight on there, 20 pound fluorocarbon line, and I'll generally put a 3/0 to a 4/0 straight shank hook in it, and it's good to go. This bait comes in a variety of colors. This particular color here is black neon. I keep my colors pretty simple. Dark water, off color water. I go with the dark colors, black blues, the black neons, June bug. And when I get into clear water, I like the green pumpkin hues, the watermelon hues. And I just really like to choose my color based on the water color. It dictates what color I use more than anything is the water clarity. So just keep that in mind when you're picking out your colors. Are you fishing clear water? Stick with the more natural colors. If you're fishing darker, muddier water, go with the black and darker colors. Now that I've talked a little bit about the structure bug, let's put it to use. Let me go out here and show you guys how I fish it and how it's been effective for me. I really like to pitch and flip this bait a lot, you know, around any type of cover. These are docks, but wood, grass, it doesn't really seem to matter. I've had success with it on all types of different cover. But the main thing I like to do is keep the bait fairly close to me. I'm usually fishing shallow targets with it. Make a pitch to my target, out past my target, let the bait fall on a slack line, and then I'll just actually just kind of start hopping it back to the boat. And the bait pretty much has all the action. You just kind of want to hop it a little bit, and it's got those appendages that are flaring up when it falls back down is normally when the bite occurs. But just remember, as it's falling on a slack line, you want to pay close attention, you know, for a bite, because a lot of times they'll bite it on the initial fall. So pay close attention to your line as it's falling. A lot of times that fish will come up and eat it, and your line will just blink. And when it blinks, just reel down and set the hook. But it's basically just a normal flipping bait. How I go about using it is how I go about using like a rodent or a game hog or what be. It's just a little different action to it. And sometimes that's all it takes to put more fish in the boat.
Another thing to remember, when you're fishing with jigs or anything vertical in water that's off color, muddy, you know, red like in Mississippi or wherever it is, dark, dark green, stuff like that. But this here is like a real tea color up in Northern Ontario here. And a lot of times, I don't care what it is, especially when you're smallmouth fishing, you're fishing away, you bring the bait up, all of a sudden you see that brown tinge turn. A lot of times, drop down, open the bail, shake it a bit, it's a good time you're gonna get bit, but you have to be watching. You know, you're looking up at the trees and say, well, look at that woodpecker, or look at the crane and stuff like that. When you're fishing, pay attention to the stuff that's going on in front of you, the areas you're fishing, and of course, when that bait's coming up in prime locations that you're fishing, always watch, because a lot of times fish, and I'll tell you why I think that is, because you're changing now where they are in the water column. If they're comfortable following it, if you're at 8-9 feet of water, they're following it in 2-3-7-8 feet of water kind of thing. All of a sudden that bait's going up, like it's trying to escape. That's the only thing I could think of. And potentially a lot of times, that's when you get them to bite. So pay attention, pitch out, fish the good stuff. When you're bringing it in, that's when you should pay attention, especially in this off-color water. Oh, a little largemouth, huh? Little largemouth. How many times I have to pitch in there before I could actually get that thing to come out, lift up and just feel the line move, and it's just a little one. You're just a little one, right? All right, okay. But I'm telling you, look at that. It's just three little sticks sticking up on this huge flat of the river. And because of the current and stuff, one little thing like that is what they relate to. It's incredible. As for colors, in tannic water, crayfish bite, you can't go wrong. Something with some orange, brown, you know, it's got some metal flake inside the head there. It's perfect. All I want is those fish to see it. If they see it, they're gonna take a shot at it. Largemouth, eh? Back of the stump. Oh boy. Oh, beautiful largemouth. Back of the stump. Man, oh man. How important is that, eh? To just fish it slow. Look at where he got it. Hey? Eh? Wow. Back and forth, back and forth. Man, oh man, I'm telling you, today is a grind. Cold front, you know, I'm just soldiering on, boy. You know, took the sweatshirt off and all that kind of stuff. But I mean, sticking it out, man, fishing this river. I got a few more spots, but they produce fish like that. And put them in the box, man, you fought good. But I really had to work at that fish. Just keep putting it in, putting it in. Let's put him in here with his brother in smallmouth. That's exactly what I mean. Going at it, taking your time, dissecting. When they're really aggressive, you know, when the sun's out, I find those fish, what they say, they almost have to go to that kind of cover. But when it's overcast like this, they can do what they want. Go around, look around, mosey around, you know. But I picked up that football jig. I decided I'm going to keep doing that. Keep doing it. Pick apart the stuff. It was sunny earlier, but largemouth and smallmouth will still relate to some kind of cover. Take your time. The water's higher. It's come down big time in temperature from 74, 75 to 66. So dissect those spots. If you're persistent, you'll still catch, even on days when it's slow. Regroup, keep fishing, maybe catch one more. Let's go. You know, I'm almost done for today, and cold fronts, it doesn't matter where you fish, from Alabama to Ontario, Tennessee, you name it, they affect fish. But when you still decide to want to go fishing, seriously, make the best of it. Give what the lake gives you, but that means sometimes tone it down, slow down, but you still want a power fish like me, consider those striking finesse football with a KVD chunk. You can put those in all the high potential spots. Even if all those spots don't have good fish, like on the good days, you'll still be putting this bait in the high potential areas, working it with confidence, focus, and you're still gonna catch some fish. So I'm hoping that before the end of this day, I'll hit a few more laydowns, maybe some grass patches that'll have some fish, and I'll have some fun. So you can go out and you can do it too. And you say, hey, I saw an extreme angler. He went and did it on the cold front. It's cold front. I'm still going fishing. I'm still going to catch him. sort of like that. Hey. It's your smallmouth bass. Hey, you put smallmouth near some kind of current, you know what's going to happen. You're going to catch them just like that. And that's how we conclude our show right here today. Catching on a cold front day. Yesterday was like 90 something degrees. Today, it's like, I don't know, 40. Water temperatures dropped to 66. But you still catch them when you're persistent. Take your time. Find little elements that the fish will hold to. In this case, it was like little stumps, current breaks, and that's how we did it. Did we wear them out? Nope. Am I going to come back again? Yep. But follow some of that stuff, and I'm sure you're going to catch them too. Listen, thanks for watching Extreme Angler. We'll see you next time when it's a little bit warmer. See ya.
Young Steels, Ford Lincoln, Interstate Batteries, CompuSolve, Top Gun Marine, Valley Fashions, Rage Tail Soft Baits. Catch us at ExtremeAnglerTV.com. Watch us, like us, follow us, see us.